Okay, good morning everyone. I am again Dr. Vivek Dhawan, Assistant Professor, Department of Pharmaceutics, Bombay College of Pharmacy, welcoming all of you to day 4 of this faculty development program on innovation management. I'm extremely sorry we started with a small glitch, but hopefully it will go all smooth hence. So we've sailed through 3 days, starting with concepts of innovation management on day 1, followed by market research and some technical discussion about excipients on how they can help us in commercializing our innovation. Finally, we saw the importance of protecting our IP and how till the point of commercialization, we can derive the profits out of it. Today, we are going to discuss about funding. That's the most important thing that we need for any innovation, any project, any startup. And for that, we have with us our first speaker of the day, Mr. Nishal Kapadia, who's going to talk on funding opportunities for fostering innovation. And I would take the privilege of introducing our first speaker, Mr. Nishal Kapadia. Mr. Nishal Kapadia is an IIMC alumni in addition to being a CS and LLB working with Edelweiss Group, one of the largest financial conglomerates. He handles strategy and projects as a part of CEO's office at the Edelweiss Global Asset Management and has presence in domestic as well as international geographies like US, UK and APAC. Edelweiss Asset Management is the largest asset manager and fastest growing mutual fund business in India, for those who are not aware of this. Prior to this role, he was the head business compliance and legal. He has been in several key leadership groups at Edelweiss from time to time, such as Emerging Leaders and Business Leaders Group. He started his professional journey with DSP BlackRock. And for, again, those who are not aware, BlackRock is the world's largest asset manager, after which he moved to Edelweiss. Apart from his professional engagements, he is very active in startup and academic ecosystems. He is an angel investor. He is mentor to many missions, including the Atlo Innovation Mission, a flagship by the NITI Aayog, where he advises various incubation centers and startups. He's mentored over 30 startups. He is also a speaker at Build Up Your Startup with Nishal Kapadia on Haiku YouTube channel. He's a regular speaker and a jury member at national level startup events organized by IITs, VJTI, Jai Hind, NM, and many more. He is also a member of the Harvard Business Review Ascent Select, several academic endeavors to his credit, member of Board of Studies at Jai Hind College, Mumbai, we are all aware of it, panel member for student selection at 6 IIMs, which is a big achievement, along with Bellinger Management Institute. He has also international connects. He's been as a guest faculty at Carleton University, Canada. He also has national accolades. He's been guest faculty at Goa Institute of Management, SIES Management Institute, which we are well aware of, Symbiosis Institute, and many more. He has shared stage with directors and principals of top academic institutions. There are many, the list is long. I would not go into it in the interest of time. But lastly, I would just mention that he has featured on various social media platforms, including YouTube, and has several videos to his credit, and we all can connect with him there apart from this platform. So with this very brief introduction, sir, I would welcome you to start off your lecture, and the stage is all yours.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for the introduction, and sorry for it being a little lengthy. So good morning, everyone. I hope each and everyone is keeping safe in these difficult times. Your family, yourself are keeping safe. The challenges have kind of receded right now, but we never know. So please be safe and respected authorities of the institution and faculty members. I'm really glad to speak in front of you. And I hope I can kind of, you know, shed some light on how funding works with regards to startups and innovation. Can we move to the next slide, please? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to first kind of try to burst some myth that exists when it comes to you know, startups or the funding aspect of it. So some myths that exist when it comes to funding, etc., and particularly with regards to startups. So generally in the media, what we see is you know, these kind of big bang you know, news headlines that XYZ company got funded to this extent, and you know, and when we see their balance sheets at the end of the year, what you really see is that there's hardly any revenue. There is huge number when it comes to the expenses, and there are massive losses. But when you see the funding, it just keeps on going and growing. Now, what is all of that is what we'll try to come across, or we'll try to see. Now, these are the things that are captured by the media, and that's why they are so loud and they sound really glamorous. But things are fairly different. And especially, it also shows that there is a difference between the traditional business and when it comes to startups or the innovative ventures that we are kind of witnessing. All right. So the first myth that I want to break, and I would try to keep myths here also, is that it is not about funding. It is about the business. It is about the business that one is building, and it's not all about funding. Because there's enough evidence or reports that exist which says that 90% or around 85% of the $1 billion funded startups also fail. And this is in addition to normal startups that fail. So when we look at what's happening, is that funding is not a measure of your success or failure. Funding is just a glamorous thing for the newspapers or the, you know, media channels. Funding does not decide whether you are successful or you are not. And we'll see how we move forward. Next slide, please. So these are some of the startups which never got as much limelight when they were small or when they were being built. But many of you would have actually used these platforms. I'm sure many of us would have used QuickHeal antivirus. We would have used SurveyMonkey for our, you know, normal surveys, Shutterstock for, you know, pictures, etc. Zoho, Zerodha is India's largest stockbroking firm. GoPro is, you know, very, very well used when it comes to adventure and all of that. Now, all of these startups are almost above, you know, $1 billion valuation they get. But they never got funded, or they never wanted to get funded. You know, they would have got funded maybe at a very later stage. But for the major part of the journey, they never seeked funding and never got funding. Which means it is about business. It is not necessarily about funding. Funding is an enabler, but not the indicator of one's success. Now I'll try to kind of, you know, speak about how does a normal business differ from a startup or an innovative venture that we kind of come across nowadays. There are some fundamental differences that exist in a normal traditional corporate business and startups. One, generally, startups are built on the theme of solving some kind of a problem that people are facing right now, but maybe haven't really taken it so seriously or haven't found a solution to it. If you see a lot of large corporate businesses, they may not necessarily be solving a problem. They may just be providing for some kind of a need or some kind of a, you know, activity, may not necessarily solve a problem. Startups generally, especially innovation, is something which is kind of, you know, gives a shade of solving some kind of a problem which everyone, you know, kind of faces on a day-to-day basis. Second is, generally, they try to target challenges that are faced by people on a daily or a weekly basis, and not necessarily on a long-term basis. So I'll give you an example. When we say you know, a large business like a, you know, Honda, Toyota, you know, it is kind of a car that they are selling, and you know, they keep innovating in their cars, etc. Now, if you see the challenge that they are trying to solve, or the problem they are trying to solve, is something which is a need for someone. Once in 2 years, 3 years, 5 years. You buy a car once in 2 years, 3 years, 5 years. You don't buy it every day. Like to like, if you see a Uber or a Ola, you might need a taxi almost every day. So if you see the difference between what they are trying to address, is Ola or Uber is addressing your daily or a weekly need, while a Honda or a Toyota are trying to address your need, which may be kind of, you know, once in 2 years, once in 3 years. So this is one fundamental difference that generally emerges when someone is building a startup while addressing a problem. And the third and the most important is the scale. Can a particular venture, and generally you'll see the startups that are funded, they generally are focused on this particular aspect, that is the scale. Now, what do I mean by scale? We have all seen Uber, right? It starts somewhere in the US. Today, it is, if I'm not wrong, around 77 countries Uber exists. What does that mean? That one format of business is created and is replicated so well across the country where it originates and across the globe in multiple countries, which means that a small idea has got a global scale. You pick up anything else, you pick up Oyo. Oyo kind of brings up a standard hotel where you are assured of the quality, assured of what you are expected to, you know, when you get into the room. It starts somewhere in India. If I'm not wrong, it's somewhere in Gurgaon region, Delhi Gurgaon region. That model gets replicated, and today it is the largest hotel chain in the world. Right? So what does that mean? That one model, it gets so well perfected that the scale at which it can go is humongous. So when you generally see startups, they are built on these three pillars. That one, they're trying to solve a problem. Like in OYO again, right? People would go to hotels and then be surprised at the quality of the rooms, etc. But that problem was solved by OYO because now you know what you expect when you go to that hotel or that room, right? So these three fundamentals, that they solve a problem, try to address a problem that one faces on a daily or a weekly basis. And third is that they have a potential to go global. They have a potential to scale significantly. So now what we'll do is we'll try funding. You know, while it is very easy to say funding this, funding that, what is most important when it comes to funding is to understand where the founders come from and where the investors come from. Once you have understanding of the requirements or the perspectives from where both of them come from, that's where funding becomes a little easier for anyone to say, kind of, you know, approach the investors, and for the investors to, you know, look at the founders and how they kind of, you know, would bet on them. So before we get into the perspectives, I'll first highlight what we generally hear in terms of, you know, who are the various stakeholders when it comes to funding, what is the range of funding people get for, you know, what they are doing. The first you know, level that comes when it comes to funding is generally your friends and your family. First level obviously is you yourself funding your own venture, right? So that's where it starts. Then comes your friends and family, where, you know, the general ticket size would be say 5 lakhs to 50 lakhs, where they know you well, they know what you are doing, you can have a great, you know good understand, you can actually explain them what you are actually up to, and they can, because they know you well, they can trust you with their money, right? So general range of what they would generally fund would be the range of 5 to 50 lakhs, right? That's the first stage. Parallel to the friends and family, there are government schemes which come in the form of grants or investments, which could come, you know, come in the range of 5 to around 1 crore. In the current dispensation, the current government has truly worked really hard to create the startup ecosystem, the innovations, you know, ecosystem, and they are working hard to allow all these innovations to kind of, you know, grow in India. So kudos to them, and this comes from the government, the grants. Then comes a range which is generally in the range of 25 lakhs to 5 crores. And this comes from the angel investors. Now, who are angel investors? As the name suggests, these are the people who come with a kind of, you know, a white knight who believes in you, who comes in your venture as an angel to give you money, because you need to kind of, you know, take your idea from ground to at least the first or the second floor. So these are the people who might be individuals. These might be a group of individuals coming together. The minimum ticket size that generally has been observed is, say, if it's in individual, it would be say a 5 lakh ticket size. With a group of people, it would be in the range of 25 lakhs. And, you know, if they are really kicked about the idea that you have, it would go in the range of, say, you know, up to 5 crores roughly, right? So if you see, there are a lot of angel networks in India. To name a few, Venture Catalyst, Our Ventures, say IPV Ventures. So these people, what they do is, they bring investors together, they present, you know, the ideas from the founders, and if the angels are interested, so assuming 100 people have come to invest, 5 of them like a particular idea, those 5 will invest in that particular startup. So this is what the angel investors do. They kind of mediate between the investors and the startups, right? Then comes the seed funding round. Now, what does this mean? One, when your business or your idea has reached a little bit of mature stage, there is some bit of market traction, there is some bit of the market has accepted what you are doing, or there is some revenue flowing in, that's where the seed fund starts coming. As the name suggests, it is a seed being sown, right? And these funds, these generally come as a fund in the kind of pool a lot of money. And then here it's not the individual investors who will invest. It would essentially be a fund similar to a mutual fund that will invest in that particular venture. And that general range is around 2 crores to 15 crores. Yeah. After that, all that happens is the early stage funds, growth stage funds. So read the seed A and B and seed B, C, D as series A and B and series B, C and D. Okay. Now, what are these? These are the stages when large institutions try to come into your venture. Why? Because they have seen that the venture is doing well. It has got trust from some angel investors, some seed funds. So people who have done some due diligence, they have agreed that yes, this venture is worth the money. And that's where the large institutional investors come into the venture. And here they start pumping large sums of money. And this can be easily in the range of 25 crores to 700, 800 to 1000 crores. Okay, we have seen such large numbers flowing in. Now, this is possible because these are funds and these are institutions who are investing. A lot of people would have heard names like SoftBank or, similar such names, These are the, funds who get money from large institutions and then they invest in the various startups. So this is the hierarchy of, how funding is kind of, received from various segments. There is a new, segment which is called as venture debt. It's a very interesting concept. So what these people do is they don't take, so all of the above, they take equity stake in your venture, which means they take, say, 5%, 10% of equity from your venture when they give you funding. What does venture debt do? They do not take equity stake. They give you a loan. Okay. They give you a loan similar to what the above people would have given you. But that loan is a structured loan, which means if you go to a bank, you have to pay EMI every month. But if you go to a venture debt fund, they will give you a structure in a way that assuming your revenues will start flowing after 6 months, after 1 year. So you can have a structure where you start paying back the venture debt, a debt fund, after your cash flows have started. Right. So it's a very structured deal that they create for you, looking at what your business is, how it is going to, kind of pan out, how it is going to generate revenues, etc. And accordingly, they give you loan. What it means is, one, you don't dilute your equity. You don't give anyone else stake in your company, which is good for the founders. But it comes with the obligation that if it is debt, if it is a loan, you have to repay the loan. And so when the structuring is done and you have put projections that after 6 months, my revenue will start coming. If it does not start coming after 6 months, then there is a little bit of a challenge because it's a loan, right? What happens in equity? If you go down, even the investment goes down. In debt, if you go down, you are now liable to pay the money come what may. Okay? So this is the broad difference between an equity investor and a debt investor. So these are the kind of different players who come in to invest in various companies. Okay. Next is what I was addressing earlier, the perspectives from which one should approach funding as such. First thing, what should the founders or the innovators think of when they are looking for funding? The first and the most fundamental question, why do I need to raise? Believe me, when I meet startups, before they have even launched their business, they just get their company registered and they start trying to connect with, venture capitalists, angel funds, etc. And it baffles me to see that you don't even know why you need funding, but you're chasing investors, right? It, as I said, it's about business. If you need money, you take money. else you will be in a serious problem because you are diluting your equity first, and second, that money has to be used for business. That money is not for newspapers. That money is for the investment in the business. And so it's important to first be very clear as to why do you want to raise money? Is it even required? Once you move from there, can you build a business plan which has multiple milestones? And can you see if your money that you want, the funding that you are seeking, can be done at particular milestones when you actually need the money and not at any stage? What does that mean? That means that assuming you have a particular business plan, say 3 years down the line, you will be kind of, you know, having a revenue of say 10 crores, 100 crores. But in the first 6 months, you will have no revenue because you are still building the business. Now, in that scenario, can you wait till you hit that 6 months period? Why is that important? Because in those 6 months, you would be able to prove to the world that one, this business is sustainable. Second, this business, the market is accepting the business, market is accepting the series, the service or product that you have, right? And when the investor looks at that, that this business has been tested for 6 months, there is enough traction, that's where the investor also is fairly confident of investing in you. And what does that confidence translate into? It translates into bigger checks. It translates into bigger money coming towards you. If someone is kind of trying to raise money at the very early stage, when it's at the idea stage or it's just at the seed stage, what will happen is the investors will try to take a lot of stake, say 20%, 30%, and give you a very small amount. Why? Because they don't trust enough that this business will really work. So they want to be in a position that if the founders can't do it, we can do it. That's why it's very important that first to create some track record and then move forward. I'm sure Mr. Vijay Kumar Shivpuria would have come across a lot of people who start up their company and immediately come for IPR, you know, that we want to register ourselves, you know, and Patlax is doing an amazing job there. Why do they want to do, get their product or service or the innovation registered so that they can approach the investors, that we have so much of IPR done at our end? Now, that's not the right approach to do. Get it registered, definitely get it registered, but build your business and then approach the investors. That's the right approach. Subsequent point, again, as I said, have milestones, try to reach your milestones, and then seek funding. One of the most important reasons one should kind of look at why one should raise funding is to build a team. I have seen so many founders; they have brilliant ideas, innovation to a level which is unimaginable. I mean, I have seen people coming from smaller towns, in fact villages, who come with brilliant innovation. What they lack is not the talent. What they lack at times is to take that idea or that innovation to a business. How will that idea convert into a business which gives you revenue, which gives you sales, which gives you a market to market your product? So if you want, or if you think that this is your need for fundraise, to get good people on board, to pay them well, then that definitely is a good idea to seek funding. Yeah, because that is a core of any business to be successful, a good team. And as I said earlier, some bad reasons to raise funds. How much is my competition raising? Some of the people in the same segment, how much have they raised? And typically, whatever I'm getting, I will take it. These are some bad reasons to raise funds, because it's about business. It's not about competition on how much and who is raising. It doesn't help anyone. These are the things that founders should be aware of and should think before going for any fundraise. Again, the fundraise period is generally lengthy. It is around 6, 8, 9 months minimum. So plan things accordingly. Now, another few things that the investor, the founder should kind of be aware of. One, when you get funding, one should be very sure that these investors are the ones with whom I'll be happy to work long term. When somebody is investing in your venture, be rest assured they are going to interfere in your business. Be rest assured that they will want to have a say in your business. in the short term and in the long run. And so one needs to be, one needs to look at this as kind of a, you know, just for the lack of better word, looking at it as some kind of a marriage, you know, that will you be happy being in this relationship? You know, that's very important. Also, one thing one should think about is, can the investor bring in something more beyond just money? And I'll explain this. Most of us would have seen the program called Shark Tank, you know, which glamorized this entire startup ecosystem and all of that. If you see all the investors who are sitting in that panel, what they brought on table. So they never brought only money with them, right? What they brought was, someone brought the entire TV channel network, which would help people to market their products. Someone brought a retail chain of retail store where physical products could be marketed in various stores across the country, and so on and so forth. So what does that mean is, are the investors bringing in some other additional value also, apart from just money? Because your product, like for example, Tata's investing in, say, a Big Basket. You know, Tata's already have Star Bazaar. Tata's as a unit are spread across the country. If they are getting into something like a Big Basket, which means that they are not bringing only money, but they are bringing a huge network, right? And that's where the synergies are built. So always look at your investors if they are going to give you something more than just money, right? And third, and the most important, and this I'll explain you with an example. One, are the investors, one, they believe in you, they trust you, and how it pans out, I'll tell you. When Twitter was launched, the first product they launched as Twitter was a complete failure. But they were already funded that time. What the founders of Twitter did, they went back to the investors and told them, please take your money back. Our product is a failure. And so we'll not like to burn your money unnecessarily, because it's not, market is not receiving it well. The story went the other way, where the investors told them, you keep the money. Forget the product. We trust you. We are sure that you'll bring in something more innovative and more interesting where this money can be used. Now, that is the kind of trust that is required from the investors in the founders. That there might be difficulties, there might be challenges, but if your conduct is so trustworthy, the investors will tell you that we are with you, let's build it further. So if this is the kind of investors you get on board, believe me, there's a huge and a long journey to kind of, you know, be a successful journey to be kind of moved forward. Yeah. Now the business end of the entire thing. What do investors look for in the founding team? Finally, they have to invest, right? They are the people with the green color notes. So what is it that they are looking when it comes to the founders or the innovators? First and foremost, do the founders have the right to win? Or do they have some functional expertise or some unique insights into what they are talking? Especially for innovators, this is a very, very important and a critical aspect. So I'll give you an example. Does anyone know what was the first product that YouTube launched? Most will not be aware. The first product that YouTube launched, YouTube was a dating site. It was not a video uploading site. It was a dating site. But in that journey, YouTube realized that just uploading videos in itself is a huge business, or has got a lot of traction. While dating was not getting a lot of traction, but uploading videos was getting a lot of traction. Now, when does that happen? That happens only when you have seen that journey and you find some insights into what people are reacting to or what people are happy doing. You know, so investors generally look for in the founders, that do they have that kind of insights into what they are building, especially in the medical field, or, you know, this kind of a field, which is more on expertise oriented field. This is what the founders would always look for, that whatever innovation that we are talking about, is there something unique that is coming, or something very insightful that is coming on table? Because if it's simple, a simple calculation of doing things, many others can replicate it, nothing difficult. But is there some unique insights that the founders have that will make them or that will give them the right to win. That's what the founders will always look for. And founders are very, and the investors are very intelligent, believe me. They can see through it. That are you coming up with some ordinary me too idea, or are you coming up with something very different or very innovative? So this is the first thing that the investors look for. Second, what they look for is how good are you at communicating your idea. This is not about personality, but this is about, because you are a founder and you are going to speak to your customers, you're going to speak to your team, you're going to speak to your investors, are you able to articulate what you have built with your idea, service, product? Are you able to articulate well to all these sets of people? Because if you are not able to do that, it is very difficult that you will be able to convince your customers. It will be very difficult for you to convince your team, right? And as I said, team is a very fundamental and a very important aspect of any venture. So if you are not able to do that, there will be challenges. And that's why what they look for, the investors look for, is are you able to, you know, do you have the ability to communicate well? Do you have the ability to work in a team or set up a team or attract good talent or even attract good advisors to your venture? In today's time, it is almost impossible for one person to know everything. And that's why you generally have a co-founder. Generally, you have a good advisory board, people who are of repute in your particular industry, who can say with confidence that, yes, I am advising this venture, I trust the founders, and they are on the right track. So if you are able to articulate yourself well and work with a good team, this is the core of what investors look for. What happened with Twitter was exactly that they trusted the founders, and that's why they got the money even after one of the biggest failures that they had, right? So this is a key point. And third, which is important for each one of us in everything that we do, more so in business, because you will come across a lot of ups and downs, is perseverance. Do you have a purpose of doing what you are doing? Or do you have the ambition to scale it to a very big extent? Perseverance, we all understand that when challenges come, you need to be able to handle those challenges. You should not get bogged down by the challenges. Purpose is, if you are building something, do you have a large purpose to, or a large problem to kind of address, which will impact a lot of people? And ambition, as I said, if an investor comes in and you want to just make a business which is good for Mumbai, which is good for Pune, that's it, then that is not what an investor wants to invest in for. The investor wants to invest in you if you have the largest of ambitions to say, first you build it in Mumbai, but take it across the country, take it across the globe. If your ambitions are large enough, that's where, now this is not just a philosophical thought. This is very commercial in nature. Investors are coming to get returns, right? And that's why if you, as your venture goes across the country or across the state or across the globe, the returns for the investors are also going to be so high, right? So when I say it's the ambition that the founder has, it doesn't just mean a philosophical statement of being ambitious. It means that, are you even thinking of making a business which is large enough so that the returns for the investors are equally high, right? We have seen examples of Zomato's and the Ubers and the Oyo's, etc. You see such large numbers, not because of anything else, because they are so large. Paytm was founded in India. It is now one of the largest payment platform in Japan. Now that is what is called as ambition. That is what is called as scale. Okay. So now let's spend some good time on these two slides. Now, as we were discussing about what do the investors look for, right? Is the market large enough to build a large company? We have addressed this point earlier, but let me kind of dwell more on this, right? How small things kind of become really large. Let's pick up an idea. If you can mute. Yeah, thank you. So if you can kind of go through some ideas that we have seen. We have burger stores everywhere in the world, right? Especially on the western side. But there's one which kind of went to a different scale altogether, which is McDonald's, right? Second, we have heard of KFC, Burger King, right, and so on and so forth. But what was, if you, I don't know how many of you understand the burger, the McDonald's story. The founders of McDonald's were known for the taste of what they were serving to the people, and they were very famous. But the challenge with them was they were too attached to what they were doing. When Ray Kroc walked into the venture, he said that we can make this into a very large business. With large business comes some compromise on taste, right? He was looking at the scale of the business that can happen, while the founders were not able to look at that, right? So what he did was he convinced the founders that give me an opportunity to open a couple of other franchisees of McDonald's and let me see what happens. As that journey began, he opened a couple of stores. They were also running well, partially because McDonald's was a known brand that time in that locality, and partially because the models that he was trying to build slowly, the founders were kind of unaware of it. So he was kind of innovating behind the back of the founders as to how can I make this a large business. He actually changed the way the fresh ice cream was made, and he used preservatives to make the ice cream. He actually changed the way the burgers, the patties were made, and made it in such a way that they would use preservatives, etc., and make and kind of, you know, be supplied to a large market. So what Ray Kroc actually did was, he actually took the business from McDonald's, the brothers, innovated himself in a way that he could transport it to a very large audience across the country. In fact, what he also did was, instead of renting out places, he started, cracked a deal with one of the investors, started buying out the properties where McDonald's store was being made, right? So he was actually being unfair on the founders, but he had a vision to make this really large, right? So these are the real ways in which large businesses are built. And many a times it has been observed that the founders are not the ones who really understand the scale that the business can be, achieved. And that's where there is a different perspective that generally comes from outside. And that's why in current times, you'll see a lot of people having co-founders. When the requirement is of technology, people bring in tech co-founders. When the requirement is of sales per se, so a lot of people who are into lending, we see a lot of smaller companies, smaller NBFCs getting into lending to cars, bikes, etc. A 22-year-old founder may not have the ability to understand the market, may not have enough ability to understand what the customers are looking, what kind of customers do defaults, etc. But if they have some people who come on board, who understand the market, who have been into lending space for some time, they will be able to guide the founders that, okay, you have a good idea, but if it has to grow big, if it has to grow like a large business, you'll have to bring in these elements. You'll have to bring in technology to monitor if somebody is going to is in a stage where their salaries has stopped. There are indicators to all of this, that if somebody is not able to service their existing credit card debt, their home loan debt, it also means that probably they will not be able to service their bike or their car loans that they have taken, right? So when you're building a large, trying to build a large, business, these things play a very important role, that you get people on board who can help you to build a vision which is beyond just what you feel. And we see that all across. If we just relate this particular concept to what was happening earlier, it was generally family businesses. And in family business, what used to happen is you had 4 or 5 brothers, cousins, etc., coming into the business, and each one would have a particular role and they would supplement each other, right? They would collaborate with each other. What is happening right now is the families are shrinking, right? And education levels are kind of highly different. And so the family business structures are kind of, coming slowly receding down. But then founders, co-founders, they are coming out with something innovative, which others really don't understand much. Now, in this scenario, when you are an individual or a couple of friends coming together, it is important that you bring in such talent in your setup so that they can give you a different perspective, which will bring in either scale, bring in either revenue, bring in either the sales, or also identify the right customer segment for you, right? And all of these things come together and play a role in the formation of a large business or a large company, right? So this is a very important aspect when it comes to how does your business start moving into the market, because that's where the real test comes in. Everything is hunky-dory when it is an idea or a product. When it hits the market, that's where the reality starts showing up its face. Yeah? And that's where you need the right advice in building a particular business. Then comes what matters in terms of money, right? It is always about, in the initial stage, it is not always about profit. We saw the first slide. It was not, you saw a lot of funding coming in. There was limited revenue, exorbitant losses, and the profits were almost, profit column was replaced with loss column. You know, most of them did not make any profits. That column was replaced with a loss column, and those numbers were also equally large. What does that mean? That means that if you're building a large business, you're building a grand business, you will have to seed it really well. The foundations will have to be very strong. And how do you do it? Depending on your idea, if you want market share, if you want numbers in terms of sales, if you want coverage, those foundations are laid in those initial stage. For example, when Oyo started, it's a very fascinating story of Oyo. When they started off, they were kind of having, they were making one hotel as per Oyo standards every month. Okay. What they realized is that there were many other startups who had come up in the same space. Okay, and they were that time largely Delhi Gurgaon oriented. They were seeing a lot of other startups coming up in the same stage, and they were doing equally well. And they also realized that it is a matter of time that someone funds these startups. Okay. And they can go at a different scale altogether. But that's where the skill of the founders came. The founders said, it is not just about funding, but it is about doing something which will keep the competition at the bay. They call this project as MI100. Okay, Mission Impossible 100. And what was that project? Ritesh, who is the founder of Oyo, he actually came, sat with the team, and he had done his homework prior to coming and speaking to the team. He said, each month, currently we are doing one hotel, we will do 100 hotels each month. Just imagine a 23-year-old guy coming and telling his team, currently we are able to do only one hotel in a month, we will do 100 hotels in a month. And the plan that he had was, day one, our team goes and does, you know, a survey of the hotel or the premises that we are trying to tap. If it suits us, great. We do an arrangement with the hotel owner or the property owner. Day two, we go and take all the, you know, measurements of whatever is required in terms of furniture, etc., right? And we have a complete idea of what is required on day two, end of day. Day three is the day when everything gets fixed in that premises, which also means you have to have the entire furniture, modular furniture, ready already. Obviously, that will be done, say, few months prior to, you know, what is going to happen. So you keep broadly, you keep all the structures ready. And when you go to a particular site, you fix it according to that, which also means there's a lot of effort that goes behind the scenes before you even go to meet the premises owner, right? So on day three, you go there and you start fixing the furniture and kind of, you know, maybe painting, etc. and all of that. Day four, you ensure that all your safety measures or all your standard requirements that you are talking about are in place in each of the premises that you are going. day 5, you actually check and be sure that yes, this premises is good to go, it's good to launch. Okay. And when they did this exercise and he had a detailed plan ready for his team, the team actually laughed at him that you are telling us the exercise that you are doing in a month's time will be over in 5 days. And you are saying that all of this can be done, you know, putting up the furniture, coloring, all the safety measures, standards, etc. in 5 days. And they actually laughed at him. The result after 1 month of their first month launch of MI100 was they could achieve the target well beyond, and they closed 130 hotels in that first month itself. What does that say? What is the thought coming from? He says that if I can capture or, you know, achieve this unbelievable task, my revenues, my gross margins will be heavy, my cash flows will start moving much faster than my competition, and my presence will be moving much faster than my competition. Right? So this is what I mean when I say that the founder comes with such unique insights that normally people cannot do. And if you see today, Oyo is miles ahead of any other similar venture in India or in the globe. Right? Now, this doesn't come by chance. This requires serious thought. This requires serious understanding of how this business works. It doesn't come just like that. And that is why when you see Oyo getting funded so much and so frequently, it is because the investors believe that these people have a track record of doing what they are doing well, you know, and they will continue to do it well, right? This is what, when you see a lot of funds flowing in some ventures like a Paytm or a Oyo or Uber, etc., huge money flowing in, the reason why these things happen without any profits, with huge losses, with huge expenses, and they still get funds, is because of this reason, that in the long run, they will turn profitable and they will achieve the target that the investors are looking for. The fact also is many of them fail, which is a reality one has to accept. But this is what the investors are betting on. Investors believe in those founders. And that's where the money flows in. So as I said, the initial stage is about gross margins or gross money coming in, the cash flows essentially. And in the long term, it is about profits. Now this, if you ask a normal financial investor, he will junk all these ideas. If it was a normal financial investor or a bank or an NBFC, you would have never seen Oyo ever coming in this world. You would have never seen a WeWork ever coming in this world. It is because of these different kind of investors who are ready to bet on people, who are ready to bet on long-term vision of the business, that you can actually see this kind of innovative business coming in the picture. Okay. So, and in today's time, the days are very good. People, if the investors see that there are people with these kind of ideas, if people see that the team that has come together is brilliant, they are happy to put in money. They will chase you for money. This is the reality of the day, right? And third, as I was talking about the scale, when one approaches the investor, etc., one should also know what is the expectation of the investor. For example, a SoftBank invest in ventures like Oyo, invest in ventures like Paytm, invest in ventures like WeWork. You know the scale that they are looking at. They are not looking at India's biggest. They are not looking at Maharashtra's biggest. They are looking at, can you be the world's biggest? This is where, say, a SoftBank comes from, right? When you understand what the investor is coming from or where the investor is coming from, that's where you will know which investor to approach. Now, this point may be a little relevant for you in today's time, there are investors who only invest in healthcare sector. They are focused on investing only in healthcare sector. Now, when you know that there are people who are looking at healthcare sector, you know if you are into healthcare sector, you'll approach them because one, they understand your business. Two, they are happy to fund you because they can analyze you. They can do due diligence on you and they can bet on you. Now, there are investors who invest in social enterprises, be it for-profit or non-for-profit. But they invest only in ventures which are socially good. And there's a long list of such, it's like Artha Ventures, OMDR Network, etc., etc. Now, if you know that these are the people who are happy to invest in ventures who are good for the society, who are good, who are looking at ventures which are good for, the social causes that they are trying to address, you will approach those kind of investors instead of going to investors who have only commercial interest in the venture. Right? Now, there are ventures who invest in ventures set up by experienced individuals. Why? Because they believe that people who have worked in, say, corporates, etc., or who have done their business for 8 to 10 years, they are mature enough to handle anyone's money. And they are mature enough to set up businesses because even their skin in the game is very high. They have their families to run. Some investors invest only in such ventures. There are some investors who invest in only women-centric ventures. Why? Because they feel that it is their duty to encourage women employment, encourage women entrepreneurship. Right? So there are these investors who are working in different segments. One needs to kind of do some research, one needs to do some reading around it, and one realizes that yes, these are the people who will be the most conducive to my kind of venture, and it's only appropriate because if somebody understands what you are doing, better to be with that person other than being with someone who doesn't even understand what you are trying to do. As they say, it's better for a doctor to marry a doctor because they both understand the challenges of what a doctor is or being a doctor is. It's like that. So if you are going to get invested or you are looking for investors, try to identify people who are more conducive to the ideas that you are bringing forward or the segments you are trying to address. So generally these points are silent points that people don't really understand or people don't really think about. But it's only when you start getting deeper in the process, you realize that these are the salient features, which if you can focus at a very early stage, your funding journey can be much faster. As I said, generally to get funded for any venture, it's the process of 8 to 9 months at least, and if you are going to invest those 8 to 9 months at wrong places, you are significantly wasting your time. So better to do your study and then move into venture, approach investors who will be happy to help you. I think the slide is stuck again. Till the time that happens, I would also encourage everyone to, during the Q&A session, do bring out questions in and around you that you see in ventures that people are trying to work on, so you also kind of get very real time or close to reality answers in terms of what should get funded and all of that. I'm sure you people witness a lot of ventures around you, so it would be great if you can bring in such real time examples around you.
Yes, we'll just proceed towards the Q&A session. First of all, I would like to thank you for such an insight on the funding opportunities and startups and what are the concerns. So, sir first started with various aspects of startups and the losses in FY 2020. He gave examples of startups like Zerodha. He had put up several logos for us to understand. And then he proceeded on what is the basis for startups, what points you should have in mind so that your startup becomes successful. He then provide insights on funding hierarchy, from what all sources can you get funding, what all points you can take into consideration, explain concepts of grants, angel investments, seed funds, stage funds, and venture debts. He also provided the founder's perspective, finally provided great insights onto what the investors look for while investing in any project and how you can take care of those points and move towards success in any startups. So if there are any questions, I would request the participants to unmute themselves and ask them. I see Nilima Thombre ma'am has raised her hand. So ma'am, can you just...
Hello.
Hello.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Sir, your session is very, you have explained all the points very nicely to us. My question is that you have mentioned venture debt. So if our startup is going on very well, means initial stage is over, but we want little bit extra fund. And that time you mentioned one point, that is a venture debt. So will you able to highlight, enlighten about that particular point for growing the business?
Sure. So ma'am, venture debt is similar to the bank loans that one gets, as I said. But the difference or the twist in venture debt is that they can structure it depending on what kind of business you are in, right? And okay. So what they do is they give you a loan, but depending on how you will be able to service the loan or what all security can you give to the loan giver, in terms of say property or the business revenue that you have or the cash flows that you are expecting already from your venture or the projections that you have. So assuming you have a venture and your current cash flow is 1 lakh rupees per month, okay, but your loan expectation is say 1 crore, and assuming for the first 6 months you say we can't pay you anything because we are investing every money that we are earning right now in the business again. So what they will do is after 6 months, they will say, you start giving us the EMIs. You will structure it in that way that looking at the projection that you have, you will get the money back, right? For which you have to give some security to them. So that is the concept of venture debt. That's a loan, but in a very different way.
Okay.
Yeah.
But sir, is there any venture debt, which who can help us? We can approach to them, any list or just like a bank, HDFC is there, HSBC is there, we can approach these people. Like this, any sure. Venture debt thing, means I don't have any idea, that's why I'm asking.
Sure. So banks, of course, they have it. In fact, if you are a woman founder, there are some grants also that are available when it comes to women founders from the government. And in terms of venture debt, there are some good names like Caspian Debt. Then I think Artha Ventures also has, they also provide debt to the founders. But Caspian is already a good name in this. They have almost disbursed around 2,000 crores to various ventures that are, there. And they give only debt. They don't take any equity stake, they give only debt.
Okay. So yeah. This Caspian is one or any other, means we have to search like that only.
Yeah, so if you do a normal Google, you will get that data. So there are a lot of players. When you say venture debt funds in India, you will get a lot of names.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot.
Sure. Thank you so much, ma'am. I see Dr. Alkam Mukhne Madam's hand raised. Ma'am, can you please unmute and go ahead?
Thank you, Vivek. And thank you, Mr. Kapadia, for that extremely informative lecture. Sure. With all of us coming from a very technical healthcare type of background and almost zero knowledge of financials, your
answer has been very
Now, my question was on a slightly lighter note, if I had to put it. We know that if you're trying to go and get venture capitalists funding your startup or something like that, it's quite a task. Hunting for the right people is also quite a task.
Yeah.
Now, is there any possibility of something like a Shark Tank type thing coming up in our country, and how viable you think something like a Shark Tank type of program, how viable will it be in our system?
Sure. So one good news is that there is one program that is coming very similar to, in fact, what I understand, it is a franchisee of Shark Tank. Just like we have the Big Boss, etc. in India, similarly Shark Tank is opening up a franchise in India. And if I'm not wrong, it will come on Sony Live. So that is one. But I would also in the same breath say that those are television programs and meant for entertainment. Better option will always be to approach the normal funding platforms or the venture capitalists, etc. Because while on TV you can get those, you know, deals being cracked in 1 minute, 2 minute, and all of that, in reality it's a very different ball game altogether. So it's always better to go with the traditional route, because that's where the real money will flow. Shark Tank or, so, and all of that is good for entertainment.
Yeah, I know, but then the sort of data that they give looks very impressive in terms of what sort of growth those companies have seen and what sort of figures and expansion they have witnessed. So is that correct, or the data is also all entertainment?
It is. No. So a lot of times it is correct. Obviously, we don't know how Shark Tank operates, but that's what happens even normally. So, you know, if you see the difference between a normal investor in any large corporate, you know, he or she will be happy with 10%, 15%, 20% of growth rate. But if you see the venture capitalist, if you see the angel investors, they will not even talk about 10, 20% of growth. They will always talk about 40%, 50%, 60% of growth. You know, what does that mean? Is that when they are investing in your venture, they are not investing for a typical growth rate. They are looking for exponential growth rate, right? And that's why when you see 90% of the startups fail. So what the calculation behind this is that a venture capitalist or angel investor, he will invest in 4 to 5 ventures, or also 10 to 15 ventures, of which 2 or 3 will succeed and the rest will fail. But when those 2 or 3 will succeed, they will give such returns, which is 60, 70, 90, 100% returns, that the losses that they have incurred are compensated. So yes, the growth that they are talking about is real growth, and that is what the expectation is.
Thank you, Mr. Kapadia.
Sure.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
This is Priya Sengupta, and I'm from management background, sir. And I have already put up my question in the chat box. And this is about the recent startups which are during pandemic, which are generally using online platform, and the investment cost for online business are not as much as the, you know, brick and mortar model business startups. So, can you please comment on that which would be a better, you know, platform for a person who wants to start up, specifically considering their own financial backup when they do not have a business history, or, you know, family backup or something like that? So do you think that we should go for online platforms instead of, you know, looking in for a big investment?
Okay, so can you just give me some color of the venture that you are talking about?
So, like, for example, today, if you go to see, there are if you talk about Instagram, so there are so many small players from small towns and cities, those who are specifically working on agro-based textiles, or, you know, agro-based clothing, yeah, and apparels. And if you talk about Nagaland and Arunachal Pradesh, there are, you know, agro-based, the jewelry, which has been exported outside. And these people, I think online has given them more penetration. So I just wanted to know that, is it a bit risky, or what? How are we supposed to be going about that? You know,
sure.
That is what.
Sure. So it's a brilliant question. I'm glad that you asked this question. I can actually give a, you know, kind of perspective to this. So earlier, the only way to showcase your product was the proper physical shop that you would have, right? And of course, you could make a big name over 10, 20 years, etc. for yourself. But the limitation always was you are limited to that area unless you open branches all across. What online has done, even pre-COVID, that it has given you a real estate shop online. So if you just equate it with a physical shop and an online presence that you have, it is nothing but a real estate shop that you are setting up, right? And so unless you, in today's time, unless you have a product or service, like what you're talking about, agro, you know, products and all, you don't need to have a physical store at all, except for the godown, etc., right? If you can generate your presence online, now, it can be through platforms like Amazon and Flipkart, or it can be through platforms like, say, Facebook or Instagram and all, right? There is absolutely no problem in that. Only thing that I would like to suggest on that is, look at it as you are doing a business on those platforms. what happens is when one is doing online, and because not everyone is, you know, tech savvy, what they do is they try to not invest enough in those platforms. Say, for example, if you have to open a shop, you will end up paying 20,000 rent. You will end up paying, say, one lakh of deposit. And I'm just giving very small numbers, right? You will end up investing in the go down, etc. But when it comes to online, people will think, nahi, ye to 2,000 mein ho jana chahiye. Ye to 5,000 mein ho jana chahiye. Right? Now understand, if you're opening a shop online, the look and feel, etc. should be equally good quality so that people get attracted to come to your platform. So understand the science of doing business online and definitely invest in it. It is the future, especially for locations that you mentioned like Nagaland, etc., where there is wealth of innovative products, etc., but they don't get exposure. And online has, I personally believe, the biggest benefit of being online is for a country like India, that it is no more required for one to be in Mumbai or Delhi, etc. One can sit in any village and showcase the product to the entire world. So definitely explore the online route, but invest as if it's a business and not just an attempt. That would be my answer. I hope that answers your question.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Sure.
Hello.
Yes.
Okay, so there are a few more questions in the chat and I will just read them out to you.
Please.
The first one is by Dr. Preeti Sangwe. She is, first of all, appreciating the session and she's saying it's a very nice session. And she's asking, have you come across any cases of startups from academic ideas which have converted to businesses or unsuccessful in commercialization? And she's saying to just give you the background, we had one such expert with us on day one. So she was an entrepreneur who, after her PhD, started up with a pelletization technology startup and has achieved success. So she says, we had one such expert with us in the forum. And do you know any more of such people? And if you can enlighten us.
Sure. So there are two kinds of education-based startups. One, of course, is those we have already heard about, like the Byju's and Unacademy, Upgrad, etc. So all of these people are taking the classroom online, right? And they are making teaching very vibrant. They are making teaching very innovative with a lot of graphics, etc., etc. So that is a typical one. And Byju's currently is the largest, not just the edutech, but the largest or the biggest or the most valued startup in India, right? So that does exist. Having said that, online has its limitation. What does that mean? That you can't have 4 Byju's in India, because Byju's will make sure that not many competition exists, right? And not in the negative sense, but just that, once people get used to one product, they stick to it. And that's why we only have Amazon and Flipkart, and we don't have 10 other big names, right? That's how online works. But there are very innovative and different kind of people coming online. I'll give you a couple of examples. One, I forget the, I actually did a panel with her. She's a doctor again, okay? And she was in practice for almost 10, 15 years. Now she has started a venture for small kids, where her physical exercises that kids do, she teaches them to do that in live classes at home. And especially in the pandemic, that has worked really well for her. She also does a lot of skill development oriented venture classes online, right? If there are these kind of things which currently are not being touched by a lot of large players, there's a lot of space in terms of education that can be addressed. So there is second or a very innovative thing that's happening, and there is this lady, Dr. Padmanabhan, if I'm not wrong. She's in the US, a neurosurgeon, and she has been in US since ages now. She has started a school which is teaching the entire curriculum in Sanskrit. She's based out of California, if I'm not wrong. She's the entire curriculum based in Sanskrit, and she's teaching this to the students. She, in the first year itself, she has 40 students from Indian origin and non-Indian origin. Okay. And she also has part-time programs. So people can continue with the normal schooling and joined these for part-time programs also. And this is just 1 or 2 years that she has started this, and she's already getting a lot of traction. Obviously, she's bringing in English, etc. languages, so that the students don't lag behind. Because in today's time, only Sanskrit may not work. So those flavors are definitely brought in. But there are people who are doing this, you know. So that's what I'm trying to say, that if you have something unique, be it in education or any field, there is enough scope, and you can get funding for that. At being online, probably you may not even need funding for that. So there is definitely a lot of scope, and one should explore that.
Yes, I think that answers the question. Thank you, sir. There is one more by Dr. Harita Desai. She again is appreciating the session. Thank you, sir, for the very informative session. And she's asking what official regulations should be followed for startups. So mainly coming from life sciences or pharmacy background, if you can throw.
Sure. So I may not be the best.
Regulations that we can follow.
Sure. So I may not be the best person to speak on that, because I'm not, in your sector of expertise. So I would want to avoid answering on that, because I'm not from that sector. I would not have enough information. Beyond that, to set up a startup, there are, you know, typical compliances that you have to, ideally you make a private limited company, you form a private limited company. There are some criterias. If you fit into that, you also get a startup status from the Startup India Foundation, where, you know, it can be categorized as a startup, and you get some concessions in terms of how much revenue and what tax you pay and all. So these are some broad level requirements or compliances. But once you form a company, it is like any other company which has to kind of comply with various things. Any CA or a CS can help you with all of that. It's not at all rocket science. As a founder, I would suggest that you hire a CA or a CS, and they should help you with that at very nominal cost also.
There is one more by Dr. Clara Fernandez. She's asking, what are the key points to be focused while pitching idea on healthcare to the investor? So she's referring to, again, it's like from the pharmacy background, we sometimes need the clinical data, because we have to prove that whatever we have made is helping the human body. So in that case, we would need the clinical data. So in such case, how do you suggest, should we approach funding resources, or should the startups, or what considerations in your mindset should be followed in case of such scenario?
Sure. So as they say, you know, that in God we trust, everything else is data. Right. So as you rightly said, if you can present a good amount of data in terms of your trials, in terms of the things that you are doing, obviously your field you understand much better. I have very limited understanding of your field. But if you can substantiate all the claims that you are making with enough data, if you can substantiate the opportunity that you are talking, that if, for example, this solution is obtained, it can address this audience or this scale of audience, it can address so many countries, etc. Right? So these two things matter a lot. One, what is the problem that you are solving and how it is substantiated, and the opportunity size of that problem, right? If these two things can be brought forward, it should be more than sufficient on this, especially in your field, because it's a highly technical field. It is always advisable that you have some advisors on board, and maybe even during the pitch session, you know, because they bring in a lot of credibility to whatever you are saying. Because assuming there are a couple of investors who understand your field better, right? They would always like to trust some senior authority speaking on that subject. So it is always advisable that in technical fields, try to have some senior authorities, be it the professors, be it deans of some colleges or some doctors of, you know, high repute as your advisors. And they need not be, you know, paid advisors. They can just be your well-wishers who agree with what you are doing, and they are happy to support you. So if you can have these three things in place, you should be good enough. The bottom line with every investor is this business going to make me money? if you can substantiate that with data, your 90% work is done.
Yes, I think that makes sense, because even we have that view, the data is everything. So the more confident you are about your data and you can convince others, it always helps everybody in the long run, right? I would actually like to ask one question. So as an academician, considering your experience with so many startups and your fruitful journey along so many years, can you give some tips or can you place your opinion on how do we motivate students to go for startups? Or, so we have this innovation council in our college and our institute. So a lot of students are a part of it, but somewhere we have this hurdle of convincing them to, pitch their idea towards startup and take that venture ahead. So from your knowledge and understanding, if you can just give us some tips on how this can be done so that we can implement it at our end.
Sure. So when it comes to students, I look at things in a very different way. Currently, the way we approach any academic program is always connected to the end job that you will do, right? And that's how we teach the students, and that's how the students take it. If you can create an environment for your students that whatever you are doing, all the experiments that you are doing, they will have a positive impact on your future career. See, getting the hands dirty, doing your project, succeeding or failing is huge experience that will benefit the students in the long run. If this message can be given to them, that it is not about success or failure, it is about doing it, right? That should change their approach, and do not connect it at this stage with the end goal of a job, etc., etc. Because that will happen anyway. If you fail in a startup, it doesn't mean that the student will not get a job or will not get into whatever field that person has to get into. But if the person succeeds or at least learns from the failure, that real-time experience will help them in the end goals. So this messaging has to happen to the students that the startups or the ideas that they have, that this is the time to experiment and fail with those things. Because in the real world, you are generally not allowed to fail. And so this is the period when the failure is appreciated, the failure is congratulated. If you can create that kind of an atmosphere at the institute that you are in, that should go a long way. I'll give you an example. Most of these co-working spaces, they have kind of a celebration evening, and only those celebrations are done, or for those startups, the celebration is done, who are happy to share their failures. So in those evenings, the 2-3 hours of sessions that they have, each one has to come forward and share how they failed. No one shares how they succeeded. What does that mean? That is appreciation of failure. If you can create that kind of atmosphere in your college, you will be doing a great job.
Yes, I think all of us have got some good knowledge on this, because as you are rightly saying, that maximum support is available to you as you are a student. And if that time you fail and learn something, that really goes ahead a long way throughout your journey. There is one more question in the chat. I just read it out to you, and I also see one raised hand. So let's first finish the question with the chat, and then I'll go to the participant. So this is by Dr. Seema Pattewar, and she's asking, if one wants to go for startup of online classes, what is the legal procedure that has to be followed? And is there any funding source that can be accessed for such type of business? And is it legal, first of all, to take the online classes privately?
Sure. So ma'am, on the legal side, I would suggest, speaking to a chartered accountant or a CS, because that's not my area of, legal is a field in itself. It's like if I were to speak on, ENT surgeon, I would not be the right person to speak on that. So I would resist from saying that. But again, it's not all of that is not rocket science. Any normal chartered accountant, etc., can help you with all of that. When it comes to doing that program, if you have students already, please feel free to do that. There is nothing illegal in that. You are not doing any crime, right? it's normal what you are doing, say for example in tuitions, what you are doing in your colleges, you can do it on online platform. Just that earlier it was classroom, now it is online. So there is nothing illegal in all of that. So that is one aspect of it. But if you're looking at expanding it, if you're looking at doing it at a large scale, then think about it, because there is already a lot of competition there in that field. So unless you are a subject specific entrepreneur where you have your own skill which you are trying to translate, that is fine. But if you're trying to build it into a large business, I would just suggest there's a lot of competition, so you may want to evaluate that particular aspect of it.
Yes, I think this is a valuable information that it is not illegal, and it sure answers the question. So I see Mr. Vijay Shivpuja has raised his hand, and I'll just request him to unmute himself and go ahead with his question.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much, Nishil, for this wonderful session. I have a question with respect to the entire startup ecosystem. We have seen this pandemic has actually disrupted lots of startups. Post COVID-19 or post pandemic world, which areas or which sectors, especially in the startup ecosystem, you see as having potential opportunities? Because every sector has been disrupted, and I am pretty sure a startup is not an exclusion in that. Yeah,
absolutely. So, just for the benefit of everyone, Mr. Vijay is a dear friend, and we go a long way. And I've always appreciated the kind of work he's doing in the IPR segment. Truly a champion. For me, he's the one person to approach when it comes to anything IPR. So that said, great question, Vijayji. The thing is that what has COVID taught us? COVID has taught us that everything that we felt was natural and normal, not necessarily is it anymore. A few examples that I can give of things that can emerge post-COVID era. Education will predominantly now become skill upgradation than just an academic course that we have been doing so far. So the formats that we currently have, 10 plus 2 plus 3 plus 2 years of masters, etc., those will slowly dilute. What will replace that is the skill development, and that process is going to be continuous forever. So anyone into such specialized skill oriented trainings, etc., will benefit a lot, right? Because now people realize that the certificates were good to that day. Now everyone has to upgrade themselves, and if it is available online, then why waste those 1 year, 2 year learning the same thing? So education definitely has a great scope. Second, in terms of what is going to change is quality aspect of things is going to go significantly up. I'll give a simple example. Today, people are worried to go out and eat. Jo tapri ka chai hai, people are worried to have it. To have the roadside vada pav, people are worried to have it. What does that mean? That now you want to be assured that the quality of whatever you are accessing is good. Imagine a hotel now in front of you who puts a kitchen with a glass in front of you, okay, and they are cooking everything right in front of you. Will you trust that kitchen more, or you will go to the traditional hotels who cook everything inside and bring you the final dish? My assumption is you will trust the kitchen or the hotel which has an open glass kitchen in front of you. Why? Because you can see if they are doing quality work or not, right? So anything quality will get a lot of traction in the post-COVID era. And third, everything that made physical environment mandatory will slowly reduce. One of the questions that we had earlier, can someone sell something from Nagaland to across the world? Earlier would have been a distant thought, no more. Now people will start having businesses just because they can access the world sitting at their home. Cities like Bombay and Delhi will slowly suffer because people will realize we can do the same job sitting in Goa, we can do the same job sitting in Ooty. So the migration, etc., will stop. So the centralization that happened in metros will slowly come down. and the tier 2, tier 3 cities will start getting prosperous. So if you want to provide quality stuff to these people, they will be consumers for that, which was currently only in the metro. So these are the 3-4 things which I see will definitely improve.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much, Nishchal.
Sure.
I see one more hand raised. Dr. Priya Sen Gupta, if you can again unmute yourself and ask your question.
Sorry, I have too many questions actually, but
I'm glad.
So you just mentioned hotel industry and OYO and tourism. I'd like to tell you this, that I was leading Kioni branch in Navi Mumbai area. They are known for their tourism. Unfortunately, things didn't work out well because of this pandemic. You know that the hotel management students as well as the tourism management students are facing the consequences of pandemic, because even the experienced people are out of job today.
Yeah. Right,
sir? So when you talk about startups, sir, there are some students from Lonavala as well as from Kankoli. These students are not very good with communication, because you were mentioning about communicating well about your startup ideas. So they are local students. So because of their local language, you know, they converted their house as homestay. Okay, and specifically now they are promoting it by mentioning hygiene factor, that we are not hotels and we do not take group bookings, individual family bookings, and home cooked food. So that is how these people started, these few 2 to 3 students of mine. And one of the faculty, sir, in the group just asked that how to motivate our students. So as academicians, sir, the best way to motivate our student is firstly being their customer.
Absolutely.
So I wanted to share this with you, that this is what it might, these things all the students might not be able to do.
Sure.
But even some start can make a difference. And you just said that the skill sets will play more important role down the line than theoretical knowledge.
So I
just wanted to ask, do you think this is the right path now?
100% it is. And I'm glad that you shared this story. I must tell you that when I go to, you know, these panels on IIMs and you know, IITs and Wellinkar and all, believe me, if I have to close my eyes and choose students who should be part of these institutions, I would go for tier 2, tier 3 and this segment of students. They may not be speaking good English, but the kind of talent that they have, the kind of depth that they have is phenomenal. And the kind of examples you gave right now is exactly what I'm talking about. They don't have failure in their dictionary. They have only working hard in their dictionary. In fact, in these kind of sessions, you should bring them to speak.
Right, sir. Because already they are demotivated, because they know they are from vernacular medium. And I personally believe that knowing English doesn't make you successful. We are Indians, and as long as we can communicate our ideas and we can connect with, because Kesari and more than Thomas Cook and Cox and Kings, Kesari and Veena World is more successful in Maharashtra. That
Absolutely.
Is because of the, local thing. So,
yes.
Thank you so much, sir.
Absolutely. In fact, I'll add on to this. It's only in India where the traditional approach is, you know, disincentivized or discouraged. If you go to Europe is 80% of the European economy is based on the tourism that, you know, people go for, right? What is tourism in Europe? Tourism in Europe is nothing but looking at their traditional, their culture, the buildings, etc. Right? The entire economy is surviving on that. Only in India, we consider that speaking English means you are something. We have to realize that our culture is what is going to be the future. A lady sitting in the US starts a Sanskrit school and gets students from across the globe. You know, this is where the world is moving. So sooner we ourselves realize, it is better for us. You know, yoga did not become popular in India till the people from the US, etc., started practicing it. That's the sad part of our country, but things are changing. And I'm sure the students that you mentioned, they will be the people who would change things for us.
Right, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much, Dr. Priya Sengupta, and sir. This was really an insightful interaction, which has enlightened all of us in the audience as well. And as you said, talking about European countries, I too feel that they very strongly stand for their culture and their language. And somewhere we have to start doing it. And yes, as students, we know they are the basis of who are going to be the future citizens. So it has to start from there. So absolutely, the sooner we start valuing our culture, language, etc., I think that's going to really put us ahead of other countries.
Sure.
I think, let me just check if there are any more questions in the chat. No. Okay, I do not see anybody else raising their hands. So I think I would formally end the Q&A session then. Thank you, sir, once again.
Before that, I just want to make one statement.
Yes.
This is purely from the point that we discussed with Dr. Sengupta. If you get time, do search for Abhijit Chawda on YouTube and listen to what he says. He is a physicist, all about science, and when he speaks about, and he loves Indian history. Listen to his YouTube videos, and you will realize where the world is and where we are. All evidence, all science based, but do listen to his videos. You'll be amazed to see on what potential we are sitting and what we are not exploiting at all.
Sure, sir. Thank you.
Yeah.
Yes, I think all of us in the audience will definitely go and have a look at this, and that's the beauty of this platform, that you get to know more than what is there only in the session, right?
Absolutely.
So all of us will definitely take the advantage of it. So with this, I think we end the Q&A session, and I now call upon Dr. Ujwala Shinde, the coordinator of this FDP, to come forward and felicitate our speaker for this session, Mr. Nishal Kapadia. Over to you, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Vivek. And it's very nice to listen so many funding opportunities from Nishal Kapadia. It is rightly said that for $1 billion idea to become a $1 billion enterprise, funds are very crucial. It is indeed true, without financial capital, any startups with brilliant idea will find itself in rough waters. Thank you, Nishal Kapadia, for graciously accepting our invitation, and your talk definitely gave us great insight about the raising money and funding sources for funds. We extend our appreciation for your valuable time with our green token of appreciation, which our research scholar, they have planted sapling of Parijat in our green BCP green campus. Harshali, could you play this video in the honor of Mr. Nishal Kapadia? This is our theme of our FDP.
Wonderful.
And Parijat plant has been, sapling has been planted in our BCP campus.
I'm so glad you are doing this. And this is the right approach to, thank and anyone. I'm so glad.
Today is also our Vatta Purnima, where we encourage, means we really value that trees are really very essential, and as a remembrance of your association with FDP, we are actually please accept our e certificate of appreciation.
Thank you so much.